There is more as well. Those questions also touch on the president's businesses, his discussions with his fixer, Michael Cohen, as well, about a Moscow real estate deal. There's a lot to get to in the next couple of hours here on CNN. We're going to go through all of it for you. Our justice correspondent is Evan Perez. Our senior White House correspondent is Jeff Selney. Our national security analyst is Julia Kayyem, and the former federal prosecutor, Renato Mariotti. Also, Michael Isikoff, the chief investigative correspondent at Yahoo News. So there's a lot of information to get to. As I said, thank you all. Good evening to you. Evan, I'm going to start with you. What do we know about these questions, and where did they come from?
Well, Don, these questions originated with the Mueller team about a month ago. They had a meeting with the president's legal team, and they essentially laid out about four different groups of topics of questions that they wanted to ask the president if he agreed to sit down for an interview with the Robert Mueller investigators. And these particular questions that the New York Times published tonight are essentially notes that the president's lawyers took. They made these questions up based on what the Mueller team was asking. And so it's a pretty good, I think, representation. We wrote a story about a month ago in which we described the four main topics. But to see the specific questions, I think, is very intriguing because, as you mentioned, you know, a lot of it has to do with obstruction of justice. But there's a lot of them, about 25% of the 50 or so questions, that have to do with whether or not the Trump campaign was illegally coordinating with Russia. So what this tells us is that the subject of collusion, despite what you hear from the White House, despite the fact that the president 15 times a day tweets out that says there was no collusion, it tells us that Robert Mueller is not done with the collusion question. I'll read you a couple of different questions. One of them in particular is one in which he says, in which the question says, what knowledge did you have of any outreach by your campaign, including by Paul Manafort, to Russia about potential assistance to the campaign? Now, we hear so far, Don, we've not heard of any particular connection. You know, the charges that Paul Manafort is facing in here in the District of Columbia and in Virginia, they don't have anything to do with Russia. They have to do with his business in Ukraine. So it's very interesting that the special counsel seems to be focused on this, and it might indicate that they have additional information. Of course, Paul Manafort's deputy, Rick Gates, is now cooperating with the special counsel. Right. And another question is about the 2013 trip to Russia, and in particular, what communication and relationships did you have with the Agalarovs and the Russian government officials? Now, the Agalarovs are some very wealthy developers in Russia, and the son of the senior Agalarov is the one who helped put together that Trump Tower meeting that has now become so controversial, become the center, really, of a lot of the questions that the Robert Mueller team has been asking of witnesses who've gone before those investigators, Don.
Yeah, a number of the questions you read, some they have to do with timing, also the meeting in Trump Tower with the attorney. So we're going to go through a lot of these questions. So Evan, stand by. Evan's got the questions and our correspondents, and we're going to go through them for you and try to figure out what this means for the investigation for the president. Let's get to Jeff Selney at the White House. Jeff, good evening to you. It looks like many of the questions are asking the president about his words, his own words, and his tweets.
Don, no question about it. It's almost like a timeline of what happened, you know, really day by day, or certainly key moment by key moment, in the president's own words. I mean, there is a volumes upon volumes of what the president you know, has said online through interviews, other things. And I was struck by, in some of the questions, one specific one was on May 12, 2017. What did you mean by this? And of course, that's when the president, after he had the meeting with James Comey, he said, look, there are tapes of our conversation. He said he better hope that, you know, he says it honestly, because there are tapes of our conversation. So clearly, the special counsel's office wants to ask the president in many certain instances what he was thinking in the moment and how that fits into the bigger a piece of the puzzle here. So the president's own words, actions, tweets certainly will be front and center of this. And we've asked the White House for a reaction and comment. We've not heard from them an answer. But Don, we do know there is still very much an active consideration discussion. Would the president sit down and testify? Mm-hmm. He has said he would. He would like to. He would like to get it over with. His lawyers have been, like, not so fast. So that is still a question mark here. at the White House.
And I wonder if these questions now being published, if that will make a difference. Stand by, Jeff. Renato, so let's go through some of the more of these questions, okay? Here's one that they're asking a lot about Michael Flynn, okay? What did you know about phone calls that Mr. Flynn made with the Russian ambassador, Sergei Kislyak, in late December of 2016? How was the decision made to fire Mr. Flynn on February 13th of 2017? Talk to me about what's behind these questions.
Well, one thing that could be behind it, Don, is don't forget that President Trump asked James Comey to let Flynn go, to let him go. And so what really is important is at that point, what did Trump know about Flynn's potential liability? That's one, I think, one reason why there may be an interest there. What did Trump know about what Flynn was doing, and when did he know it? That would be one thing that would come to mind.
All right, Juliet, here's and there's more. What did you know about Sally Yates' meeting about Mr. Flynn after the resignations? What efforts were made to reach out to Mr. Flynn about seeking immunity or possible pardon? Anything surprising here? What is Mueller after?
Saw that one.
This is the focus on obstruction of justice. After the fact, after he does fire Flynn, were there communications between Trump and Flynn to get Flynn not to talk? Remember, now Flynn is talking and telling us his story. And so the totality of all of these questions is not just obstruction of justice. It just has to be said here. These questions are jaw-dropping because everything is on the table. I mean, whether it's collusion, cooperation, whether the president is compromised, the entirety of these questions, including the ones about Flynn, suggests that Mueller does not believe it's all a coincidence. And that, I think, is the takeaway tonight. This is not just an obstruction case. This is still at the core of the finances and the election and potential collusion.
Okay, Michael Isikoff, my first question I had when I saw this cross and I read it, I said, who leaked these? Where did these come from? Do you think this was leaked by someone from Team Trump?
Well, look, it's hard to imagine that anybody on Mueller's team leaked them. And given what the obvious impact of this leak report, very, and I agree with Juliet, jaw-dropping report, is that it strengthens the case for those on the president's legal team saying you can't go in for this interview. And in fact, it's hard to imagine any criminal defense lawyer seeing a list of questions like that who would let his client speak when there would be so much at risk, because as everybody's mentioned, these are so broad and so wide-ranging, and you know, the likelihood is that it buried in there is, you know, Mueller's going to know the answer to a lot of these, and the president would be exposed to perjury if he lied.
Do you think there's, Michael, you think they're speaking to the president through the television, as is so often said, from people who are part of his administration?
Yeah, I think that, you know, one never knows, but part of this has to be people trying to persuade the president by building pressure for him not to cooperate with Mueller. The other takeaway from this is it makes it crystal clear that this investigation isn't going to end anytime soon, which is what Rudy Giuliani seems to be suggesting. He could wrap things up in a few weeks. He was talking about obstruction, but clearly every one of those questions about the president's past and his business dealings in Russia and his relationships with various players like the Agalarovs, every one of those is inextricably interwoven with the question of obstruction. Was there something the president was trying to obstruct to prevent the public and the prosecutors from knowing about? So Mueller can't wrap up the obstruction issue until he knows the answer to all these other matters.
So Evan, I just looking over the questions, and I'm sure you've read them as well, can you tell from these questions whether Mueller considers the president a subject of this investigation? Remember, that was he was told that he wasn't a target, but he was a subject. Can you tell from these questions?
Well, I think clearly he is a subject, and I think it's very easy for you to go from subject to target. That's the reason why, as Mike was just saying, it's so easy and so difficult for any lawyer to see these questions and think, okay, this is a good idea for you to go in and do this interview. Look, I think when we reported our story a month ago about the four main groups of topics, and we knew that there were about 50 questions that the team had come up with based on their conversations with the Mueller team, what we were told, what the conversations we were talking to people really made it clear that there was a lot of agitation inside the White House, the legal team. I think they looked at what Mueller was laying out and they thought, boy, we can't do this. And so this really crystallizes why there was a lot of agitation. Of course, it was after that John Dowd left the legal team. So there's been a lot of change since then. But Don, this explains a lot of what we were sort of seeing and sensing behind the scenes of a lot of agitation about where this investigation could be headed and the danger signs that were flashing really before their eyes.
Jeff, you're able to just from being there sort of monitor and maybe understand and predict the mood of the White House or how they're going to respond to this. No response so far because this just broke. But I'm sure this morning or maybe in a tweet tonight, we may be hearing something about this.
Certainly, possibly. The president was actually having dinner outside of the White House earlier this evening at about the time when this was coming in. He was at his hotel, of course, just a couple blocks from here at the White House. But since then, it has been very silent around here. But you just have to certainly, I think, if anything, this does, it is a reminder, as Evan was saying earlier, the president can say witch hunt, hoax, you know, this investigation's over as much as he wants. This underscores how it is not. And most of his aides and advisors, in fact, all of them in this building recognize that. And it seems to me if someone on his side would have leaked these or let them out, it is, you know, a wake-up call if he still wants to and is eager to sit down. I think this certainly makes it look like, look, this is not at the end. This does not look like the finish line is right in front of him here. Mm-hmm. This has a long ways to go.
All right. Jeff, thank you very much. Everyone else, stick around. We've got a lot more to come on our breaking news tonight. The list of questions Robert Mueller wants to ask President Trump. That's according to the New York Times. We're going to talk about all of that. That breaking in the Times now, we're going to answer, at least not answer, but ask, read to you some of the questions that that Mueller wants to ask the president. That and what the special counsel wants to ask about the former FBI director James Comey as well. We'll be right back. So we're back now with our breaking news tonight. It's huge news, and it might be the best window yet into this Russia investigation. The special counsel, Robert Mueller, has a list of nearly 50 questions that he wants to ask President Trump on his ties to Russia, on obstruction of justice, on his business, and on his family and closest advisors. Back with me now, Evan Perez, Julia Kayyem, Renato Mariotti, and also Michael Isikoff. I'm just going to read something from the New York Times that sort of sums up what this is about, and then I'm going to have questions for you guys. It says, the open-ended queries appear to be an attempt to penetrate the president's thinking, to get at the motivation behind some of his most combative Twitter posts, and to examine his relationship with his family, his closest advisors. They deal chiefly with the president's high-profile firings of the FBI director and his first national security advisor, his treatment of Attorney General Jeff Sessions, and a 2016 Trump Tower meeting between campaign officials and Russians offering dirt on Hillary Clinton. Juliet, that sums it up.
Yes, it does. And there's some of the specific questions are phrased really interesting. Now, remember, this is a transcript, so we don't know the specific questions. But they talk about the Trump campaign's outreach to the Russians, not what we have come to believe, which is the Russians tried to penetrate the Trump campaign. I don't think that's an accident. I think the question is how aggressive was the Trump campaign? And as I was saying earlier, you know, we don't know what the verb is or the word is, colluded, cooperated, whatever. But this issue is not going away in terms of the campaign. Look, the president, the totality of this, I just want to make this clear, is the president is in some trouble if he can't answer these in a way that that puts to rest some of these questions. But we are also in trouble because behind these questions is the Russians and their capability and success of penetrating a campaign for president of the United States. And nothing has been done to stop them in 2018 or 2020. And we do not know what the Russians will do to keep that fact secret. And so this is not just about Trump, it's about us. And it's just worth reminding people that this may seem you know, oh, legalistic. It's actually quite, you know, it's quite existential for us about what's going on.
Yeah. Let's talk about the questions now. Let's go right to Michael. There are questions about Comey. Okay, so I'm going to read it. What was your opinion of Mr. Comey during the transition? What did you think about Mr. Comey's intelligence briefing on January 6, 2017 about Russian election interference? What was your reaction to Mr. Comey's briefing that day about other intelligence matters? What was the purpose of your February 14, 2017 meeting with Mr. Comey, and what was said? What was the purpose of your January 27, 2017 dinner with Mr. Comey, and what was said? So the special counsel, Michael, wants answers on why Comey was fired, questions about the dossier and about the loyalty test, all about asking Comey to let the investigation into Flynn go. What's your reaction?
Yeah, I mean, look, that goes squarely to the issue of obstruction. What was in the president's mind when he fired Comey, when he began the process of deciding to fire Comey, which, as we've talked about in Russian Roulette, the book I have with David Cornow right now, really begins with that January 6th briefing. It's President-elect Trump at that point, but the intelligence chiefs are briefing him about the Russian interference campaign. They all leave the room except for Comey. Comey gives them the tells them about the synopsis of the salacious allegations in the dossier. And after that, what Comey didn't know, but which we report about in the book, is the president blows up. He believes it's blackmail. He believes that Comey's trying to shake him down to let him know that he's got something on the president, or the president-elect at that point, and that's where the seeds are planted for the firing of Jim Comey. Mm-hmm. It's likely that that Mueller already understands that, knows that, and it does lead to questions about everything the White House said publicly about the reasons for firing the FBI.
Evan, I'm wondering, now that these questions are out there, can the president's team now argue for him just to reply to these questions on paper? They're out there. He can answer them on paper. He doesn't have to come in and be deposed, so to speak.
Well, yeah, actually, Don, that's one of the arguments that they are making, and that's why the negotiations are still ongoing. We don't know, by the way, whether Mueller is amenable to that. It seems like it's probably unlikely, because part of the reason why you ask questions and you want to interview someone is because you want to see the body language. You want to see whether or not they're being evasive. You don't want to give them a take-home test and have someone else fill out the answers for them. That's not the purpose of this exercise. So I just want to add real quick to what Mike was saying. I think what this sets up, I mean, the questions you asked, you read just now about Comey, really sets up an interesting clash here, where we know Comey's version of events. Obviously, the memos are now out. He's got this book out. So we know his version. He's been in TV interviews everywhere. This sets up where, you know, whose version of the truth you're going to believe here. Is it Comey's, or are you going to believe the president's? And that's where I think there's so much agitation in the White House over exactly how that will end up.
All right. Renato, another key question here. What did you mean in your interview with Lester Holt about Mr. Comey and Russia? And that's where President Trump told Lester Holt that he was thinking about the Russian investigation when he fired Comey. Let's listen and I'll let you respond.
Regardless of recommendation, I was going to fire Comey, knowing there was no good time to do it. And in fact, when I decided to just do it, I said to myself, I said, you know, this Russia thing with Trump and Russia is a made-up story. It's an excuse by the Democrats for having lost an election that they should have won.
Renato, what's your reaction?
Well, clearly many of these questions, Don, are meant to try to pin down the president as to what his intent was when he was firing Comey. Look, you can fire the president can fire the FBI director for legitimate reasons. Like, for example, he thought he did a bad job. He thought he was not a good FBI director. But if you're firing the FBI director in order to stop an investigation into you or your friends, that is obviously obstruction of justice. And so all these detailed questions about tweets and conversations and what did he think of Comey before before meetings and so on. And obviously this question about the interview, they're all meant to try to pin down the president as to what his intent was. And I will tell you, Don, the fact that so many of these questions deal with intent and deal with obstruction tells me, and really it's a conclusion I've drawn for some time, is that it's very likely that Mueller is zeroing in on obstruction and believes that Trump is likely obstructed justice.
All right, everyone stick with me. We've got a lot more to come on our breaking news, a leaked list of questions Robert Mueller wants to ask President Trump. What does he want to ask about Attorney General Jeff Sessions? We'll talk about that next. All right, we're back with our breaking news tonight. Nearly 50 questions Robert Mueller wants to ask the president to determine whether he obstructed justice. Back with me now, Evan Perez, Julia Kayyem, Renata Mariotti, and also Michael Isikoff. Okay, so Evan, this first one's for you. There are also questions related to Attorney General Jeff Sessions, right? So it says, what did you think and do regarding the recusal of Mr. Sessions? What efforts did you make to try to get him to change his mind? Did you discuss whether Mr. Sessions would protect you and reference past attorneys general? What did you think and what did you do in reaction to the news of the appointment of the special counsel? So Evan, the president has been very clear about how he feels about Sessions, but the special counsel still has a lot to ask him about that.
Right, and Don, he has a public record. I mean, the president has spoken about it. He's spoken about how he believed that Eric Holder, the previous attorney general, actually did a good job of protecting President Obama, and that he sort of wishes that Sessions would have done that for him. That's the insinuation he made. So I think the special counsel is armed with a lot of the president's own public statements, his tweets, his comments that he's made to his friends, which are then leaked to the press. So there's a lot of material to work with. And look, the fact is that Jeff Sessions had no choice but to recuse himself in this investigation, simply because he played a role in the campaign. He was an active participant in the campaign, and the Justice Department rules make it abundantly clear that he had to recuse himself. The president doesn't buy this, but that is the truth. And so he's been mad at the attorney general for basically doing what he had to do, he was required to do under the rules of the Justice Department.
Renato, I have to ask you, because when you're dealing with obstruction, I'm not an attorney, but that's what I hear from the attorneys here and from the legal folks, that you have to establish intent, mm-hmm. correct? What is the intent? And
correct.
I'm wondering if the president's public statements, his tweets, what he said, is that going to come into play? I played the Lester Holt interview. Will that come into play when they're trying to figure out what his intent was behind any of these meetings or questions or any of his actions?
No question. So what Mueller has to prove is that the president had corrupt intent. In other words, the intent to unlawfully, you know, interfere with or impede the investigation. And the way you prove as a prosecutor somebody's intent, obviously you don't have a magic telescope that sees inside their brain. So you look at their words and you look at their actions over a long period of time, and you ask a jury to form conclusions about the person's intent from those words and actions. So, for example, why was the president so angry at Jeff Sessions for doing what he was legally required to do by recusing himself? Why did he talk about the attorney general protecting him? You know, why did he, you know, fire James Comey? Why did he tweet about there being tapes during the conversations? All these specific questions that you are reading, Don, relate to actions that could be used by a prosecutor to infer that the president was trying to act with the intent to impede the investigation.
Okay, Michael, a lot of questions on here related to the campaign's coordination with Russia. Questions like this one: when did you become aware of the Trump Tower meeting? What involvement did you have in the communication strategy, including the release of Donald Trump Jr.'s emails? During a 2013 trip to Russia, what communication and relationships did you have with the Agalarovs and Russian government officials? What communications did you have with Michael D. Cohen, Felix Sater, and others, including foreign nationals, about Russian real estate developments during the campaign? Do these questions show, Michael, that collusion and possibly conspiracy are still very much on the table?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think that's unquestioned. But, you know, look, what's lurking behind every one of these questions is, what does Mueller know that the Trump team doesn't, given the evidence, the testimony he's gotten from Michael Flynn, from Rick Gates, from George Papadopoulos, given that, That makes this so problematic for the president to go into a deposition with this. And just as an example of what could be lurking out there, just in the last few days, with the release of the House Intelligence Committee report, there are data points, little nuggets that tell us that, that fill in some of the blanks, including the fact that Michael Flynn, in December 2015, and his son met with Ambassador Kislyak at the ambassador's private residence. That was the first indication that there was any prior relationship between Flynn and Kislyak, and raises, you know, a whole host of questions about, did they continue to talk during the campaign, not just after the president was elected during the transition. Similarly, there's an email that Flynn sends on July 14th, 1 week before the WikiLeaks release of the DNC emails, saying there are cyber activities that have happened and will happen in this election involving nation states and the DNC. That's pretty eyebrow-raising email. And remember, Flynn has now cooperated. He's had to tell Mueller everything.
Okay. Juliet, same question. Conspiracy, a possible conspiracy, collusion still on the table. Do you get that from these questions?
Absolutely. So there's a series, and not just from everything we've been saying, the fact that the questions are being asked about the election, about real estate deals, about meetings that took place before the election. There's a series of questions that if you are not Trump, but you know something, are going to make you nervous. And that's the ones about other co-conspirators. So there's a question about who else knew about your plans about firing Comey. There are specific questions about Jared Kushner, whose name is explicitly stated in the questions. And so, you know, look, this is, as I've been saying, this is how a conspiracy unfolds, is everyone gets nervous about everyone else. And if, in fact, there is a conspiracy to either, you know, collude or to cooperate or to undermine an election, each person is going to eventually be out for themselves. So the whole co-conspirator line of questions in what we just saw tonight are absolutely fascinating and will probably be terrifying to a bunch of people who've been sort of outside our focus lately.
Well, what's interesting to me is that it says, what communication did you have with Michael Cohen, Felix Sater, and others, including foreign nationals and Russian real estate developments during the campaign? And then we know 2 weeks ago, his personal attorney's office and home and hotel room were raided from the FBI. So that is factoring into these questions. What talk to me about that, can you, Renato?
Well, absolutely. You know, what we don't know and what's really not in these questions is what information does Mueller have about some of these other categories? You know, to me, the most interesting thing that I gained from reading these questions, Don, was you noted that all the questions about the obstruction issues and the intent issues are very highly detailed. They talk about specific tweets, specific conversations. A lot of this stuff about collusion is very high level, very vague. You know, what did you know about this? What did you know about that? Very broad topics. And I find that really interesting. And what it suggested to me was a lot of this other stuff has been reported by the media at length. You know, all these tweets and conversations and blow-ups and so on. But what Mueller knows about these the Russia trip, the 2013 trip to Russia, or conversations between him and Cohen and so on, you know, the president really probably doesn't know what Mueller knows about these. Mm-hmm. So I think they kept those very vague and very high level so they could be more specific later on and not tip their hand to the president's team.
Thank you all. I appreciate it. We've got a lot more to come tonight on our breaking news, that list of nearly 50 questions that Robert Mueller wants to ask the president and how that could shape the Russia investigation. So here's our breaking news tonight. Special Counsel Robert Mueller has dozens of questions that he wants to ask President Trump to determine if he has obstructed justice and to examine his ties with Russia. That is according to the New York Times, which obtained the list. So I want to talk about this now with senior political analyst Patrick Healy, political editor at the Times, contributor Frank Bruni, a columnist for the paper, CNN White House reporter Sarah Westwood, and CNN legal analyst Michael Zeldin, who was Mueller's special assistant at the Justice Department. Boy, do I have so many questions for you. Good evening, for all of you. But Frank, I want to start. What is your reaction? Dozens of questions the special counsel wants to ask the president. What do you think?
Well, you know, when you read the questions, they're exactly the questions we've all been asking. You know, I mean, they're exactly the logical questions, and they show that nothing's really off the table. There are questions that pertain to collusion. There are questions that pertain to obstruction of justice. And I think they're also a reminder that this investigation will not feel complete unless Robert Mueller has a chance to ask the person at the center of it, Donald Trump, some questions. Whether he will get to remains to be seen, but that he very much wants to and is making the plans accordingly, I don't think that's a surprise.
So before I could get to, do you want me to stand by? Okay, I'm gonna stand you guys by. Sorry, we have a more breaking news there, because I want to bring in now on the phone Representative Adam Schiff, who's a ranking member of the House Intel Committee. Congressman Schiff, thank you so much for your reaction to this report. Thank you for coming on and giving us your reaction to this report. What do you think?
Well, you know, I would certainly agree that it's a broad list of questions, and I'm glad that it is as extensive as it is. It means that the special counsel hasn't been forced to agree with the White House to limit the scope of his questioning. There are some things that are notable, though, that are left off the list that do give me concern. And one is the area that the president has tried to draw a red line around, and that is the finances of the Trump Organization. I think there ought to be questions about, did the Trump Organization receive Russian money? Was Russian money laundered through his properties? Did he have any knowledge of Deutsche Bank's laundering of Russian money because he was doing so much business with Deutsche Bank? Those are questions that I think the president ought to be asked that I did not see on the list. There also were not questions about whether the NRA was one of those back channels. There were questions about other back channels that Jared Kushner explored, setting up with the Russians, the meeting in the Seychelles. But notably absent from the list was questions about the NRA. So there were a few areas that I think were excluded, but nonetheless, what we do see on the list focuses a lot on obstruction of justice, I think for pretty obvious reasons. And a lot of those questions are going to be darn difficult for the president to answer, particularly why, if the justification was for the firing of James Comey was his handling of the Clinton email investigation, why had he been praising Comey over that previously? These things are going to be very difficult for the president to explain away, and I could understand his lawyer's reservations about having him talk to special counsel, but special counsel needs to insist.
But Congressman, there could be questions about that. I'm not sure, assuming that this is the entire list of questions and the exact questions that are going to be asked. But those are inquiries that you would like to, or at least the kinds of inquiries you would like to be touched on.
Yes, you know, it's certainly, you know, the list that was put together looks like a very reasonable ask of the special counsel. Those are all areas where, you know, particularly, you know, they shed light on the president's intent behind the firing of James Comey, the degree to which they might have floated pardons over people, his interference in whether Jeff Sessions would recuse himself. All of that goes to whether he was affirmatively trying to obstruct an investigation into his own campaign. So those are, you know, perfectly important, appropriate questions to be asked. There are also questions on the collusion issue. There are some questions on the effort to seek business in Russia. You know, that intriguing question about Paul Manafort. Are you aware of any effort by your campaign, including, and he's the only one singled out, Paul Manafort, to obtain Russian assistance? You know, that could mean a few things. That could be, you know, efforts to, by Cambridge Analytica, to seek out the stolen Russian emails from WikiLeaks. It could be Roger Stone inquiries, although he merits his own question. But it also could allude to something that is not in the public eye that Bob Mueller knows. Or, you know, one other possibility, Don, is that this question is a bit lost in translation, because if these questions were obtained from the White House, they're not the questions as written by Bob Mueller, they're the questions as rewritten, as notes taken by the White House lawyers.
It's a summation of the question.
So it could have been they were asking about Manafort's outreach to Oleg Deripaska, this guy close to the Kremlin, mm-hmm. where he's trying to get money from Deripaska, and he's offering information on the campaign. So that question could be garbled, or it could be that it goes to information special counsel has that he didn't want to elaborate more than he did in that question.
Let me ask you a little bit something else, because I posed this question during my last panel session. And I said there were a lot of questions related to the campaign coordination with Russia. And in that, Congressman, business dealings do come up. And I'll read it. When did you become aware of the Trump Tower meeting? What involvement did you have in the communication strategy, including the release of Donald Trump Jr.'s emails? During a 2013 trip to Russia, what communication and relationships did you have with the Agalarovs and Russian government officials? What communications did you have with Michael D. Cohen, Felix Sater, and others, including foreign nationals, about Russian real estate developments during the campaign? That's about business dealings right there. And the question that I asked the panel before was, does it seem to you, when you hear questions like that, because the president has been saying no collusion all the time, does it appear that the possible obstruction of justice and possible collusion still on the table?
Well, certainly. I mean, if the special counsel were at the point where he had reached the conclusion that there was, clearly no evidence of collusion or obstruction of justice, then these questions wouldn't be necessary. But in fact, there is evidence of obstruction in the firing of Comey and in these other subject matter areas that the special counsel is asking about. And there is evidence of collusion in that meeting in Trump Tower, in the approach to George Papadopoulos, in the Russian previewing of the dissemination of these stolen emails, in the Trump campaign's efforts to obtain this information, the president's own son saying he would love to have the help of the Russian government. It's perfectly appropriate, indeed necessary, for the special counsel to ask about this. We write about a couple of these things in the Minority Views we just put out.
That's what I was going to ask you. Did you get to ask the questions that you're reading in the New York Times? Did you get to ask the bulk of the questions to the people you interviewed? I mean, these are some of are specific to the president, but it is the type of things you would have asked during your hearings.
Yes, but it's also the type of things that witnesses refuse to answer. And, the perfect illustration is the cover-up of the Trump Tower meeting, the false statements that came out. Well, this was only about adoptions. We asked Corey Lewandowski about that. He refused to answer. We asked Don Jr. about his conversations with his father, where they concocted allegedly this false statement together. He refused to answer the questions. We asked Hope Hicks about it. She refused to answer the questions. We asked Steve Bannon about it. He refused. And the Republicans were only too happy to take no for an answer. None of them would press the point. So when my Republican colleagues say no collusion, they're both ignoring the obvious evidence that's very public about collusion, but they're also obscuring the fact that they prevented us from finding out the answer to very important questions about collusion. And one of the ones we highlight in our report is in the setup to that Trump Tower meeting, there are calls going back and forth between Don Jr. and Amin Agalarov, the son of the Russian Donald Trump.
Talking about the block number, too, when...
The block number is a call that takes place, an incoming call that takes place between two calls between Don Jr. and the son of this Russian oligarch. Now, the president used a block number during the campaign, and what we wanted to know is, okay, who is this call from? Now, the president's son claimed not to know, not to remember. That doesn't seem particularly credible, but there's an easy way to find out. We could subpoena the telephone records, but the Republicans were unwilling to. They didn't want to find evidence of collusion, so they ignored the evidence we found, and they made it affirmatively impossible to find out additional facts.
Congressman Schiff, appreciate your time. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Don.
50 questions at least that the special counsel wants to ask the President of the United States regarding Russia, possible collusion, campaign interference, election interference. We'll be right back. All right, we're back now with our breaking news, and I'm back now with my panel, Patrick Healy, Frank Bruni, also Sarah Westwood, and Michael Zeldin. Frank will be along in just a minute. But I want to talk to Patrick. You heard, Patrick, what the congressman said. What was your reaction?
What stood out the most, Don, was his point about what Bob Mueller may know that is not reflected in these questions. We have Michael Flynn, who has pled guilty. We have Papadopoulos. We have Rick Gates. We have people who may have given information, including James Comey, to Mueller that we don't know. And that creates a real danger for President Trump. He has these questions, certainly. He can prep, his lawyers can prep him for these open-ended questions, but they don't know if President Trump goes into that interview and he starts, as we both know, Don, talking the way he usually talks, which can veer very quickly into exaggerations, into falsehoods, into lies, whether he is going to be ultimately caught out by some piece of information that Bob Mueller knows because Michael Flynn has given him some kind of evidence on this, or Rick Gates. Yeah. It's a very tricky situation for President Trump to go into. And how do you prep President Trump in this kind of situation, Don? I mean, again, you know how he is. He's not someone who sticks to a script. He's someone who can get very proud and very defensive. And he can say things.
And he wants really, to answer the, that's his personality.
He wants to. And the reality is, the political strategy of this is that if his lawyers are probably arguing, do this in writing, we can vet it. But then you catch him out and you say, well, what have you got to hide? Why are you afraid to sit down? You know, Bill Clinton sat down with Ken Starr. What do you have to hide? And they may be able to, you know, essentially goad him into a very difficult situation.
Yeah, you talked about the people who pled guilty, George Papadopoulos, Mike Flynn, Paul Manafort, Rick Gates, and then there were two. There was also Van der Zwan and Richard Pineda. But this was part of the just Mueller's probe, not specifically connected, all of them, to the president.
Right. Well, Michael Flynn. I mean, Michael Flynn, ultimately, yeah. and Rick Gates during the campaign, some of these questions get
So, out. Michael, here's I'm curious because those phone records that Adam Schiff just spoke about now, wanting to know whether that block number might have been the president. Would the special counsel have those records already as part of this investigation, or at least access to them?
I would assume that Bob Mueller has subpoenaed all of that and has it. And
he would know who that block number is?
I would think so. If it's knowable, I would think he would know it, sure.
Okay.
I think that, you know, we don't know whether it's knowable, but if it's knowable, I think Bob Mueller will know it. And we should presuppose that with all of these questions, Bob Mueller has a lot of information. He's formed an opinion about the sort of timeline or the essential core facts which he believes to be true, and now he's going to ask the president for his opinion about each of them. I don't think this is in any way, shape, or form a perjury trap, as some guests have sort of implied, in a sense that they're going to try to catch him up in something. I think these are going to be fair and open-ended questions where the president, if he's truthful, should have no problem in avoiding any sort of perjury or false statements. It just has to be truthful.
If he tells the truth and there's nothing there, then there's no perjury to worry about.
Exactly. Yeah. And, you know, there are some questions here, though, that are complicated. There's a question here, Don, about sanctions, whether there was any discussions with Russians about sanctions.
I'm going to get to all of that, but I need to bring Sarah in before I have to get to the top of the hour. What's the biggest question you have for the White House tonight?
Well, I think, look, the big question is whether President Trump is going to sit down and answer these questions in person, make himself available for a long period of time to address all of them, or whether they're going to try to funnel the president's answers into some kind of written response. Obviously, that's the approach that his lawyers would prefer, to minimize his legal exposure. We don't know how aggressively the Mueller team is going to try to push to get the president to sit down with the special counsel. So it'll be interesting to see whether the legal team feels with these questions in hand.